Chapter 19. Not only had Vivian never been in love before, but she had also never experienced the agonies of love gone awry, and it staggered her to discover how terrifically they hurt. The certain knowledge that Gregory did not want her, combined with the awareness that, after her night at his apartment, he knew exactly how much and in what way she wanted him, filled her with embarrassment, anger, and deep pain. Multiple times a day, the vision of him as he had looked when he had entered his apartment that night rose up before her in full detail. Hardly surprising, since the scene had become permanently etched onto the backs of her eyelids. She would close her eyes, and there he would be, this radiant being, satisfied of all desires, while she burned for him in an agony without end. How could it be that Gregory could feel all of this searing and passionate heat for someone somewhere else, but not for her, was too agonizing to closely contemplate. He said he had not been with anyone else, but anyone could see that something must have happened. The more she thought about it, the more she found herself approaching that complex emotional morass where betrayal, hatred, and hurt love overlap. In short, she was coming to learn about that dark place, the hidden, jagged corners of a broken heart. She was suddenly ashamed of having given her love to him so freely and so openly, and this also made her determined at all costs to hide from others that he had done the rejecting. Walking around red-eyed or quietly sobbing were out of the question, so she did her best to stuff all of her suffering deep down within her chest, where it sometimes threatened to overflow, but where, for the most part, she was able to keep it in check. This self-restraint came at a cost, however, which was that she was visibly angry and bitter much of the time. She was short with her mother, she skipped a planned visit with Nadine, and the day of the now loathsome picnic and hike to Lake Pontchartrain, she stomped around irritably and spent a good portion of the time only pretending to listen to people, while angrily throwing pebbles and small rocks as far out into the water as she could. When Gregory had left, her mother had asked her if everything was all right, and Vivian had said everything was fine, why wouldn't it be, but that Gregory had been rude to her and belittled her and treated her like a child instead of properly as a young woman. Her mother told her that she was certain Gregory had not meant to offend, and that it was not completely inexplicable that he should see Vivian as a child, since he was more than a decade older. Then her mother carefully pried for more information on their falling out, but Vivian made it clear that she would explain no further. She wanted her mother to know what a deceitful skunk Gregory Morgan was, but at the same time, and for reasons she could not entirely explain, she also did not want her mother to know that he had never intended to court her or to marry her. Her mother might follow that information up with questions on whether Gregory Morgan was some sort of a roué who only intended a lust-filled dalliance with Vivian, although he would not consider marrying her a poor seamstress. And then that could lead to the even more painful admission that Gregory Morgan did not even want a brief dalliance with her. Because this much was clear. He wanted nothing of the sort with her. She was not old enough, not wealthy enough, not educated enough, and possibly not even beautiful enough. Certainly she could not hold a candle to the woman in the picture in his bedroom. What more was to be said? And his protestations that he loved her and had always wanted some sort of bizarre, quasi-spiritual friendship with her, well, those were just the feeble excuses of an ashamed young man whose deceits had now been exposed. She was thinking all of these bitter thoughts and angrily tossing rocks into the lake, becoming gradually aware that Mabel had stopped speaking to her and had, in fact, gone some time ago, when Vivian heard steps in the grass behind her, and then a pleasant-sounding laugh. She turned around. It was sandy-haired Chester Westcott, or Chip, as he was better known to the group. He had arrived late and must have just found the picnic site. "Do pardon me, Miss Vivian, but I see that you have not given much effort to athletic sports. Your throwing arm is not very good. Here, allow me," he said, in his interesting British accent, picking up a nice-sized rock and propelling it forward so that it landed far in the lake with a satisfying plop. He smiled his wide, easy smile. "Oh, hello, Mr. Westcott," said Vivian. "I would prefer just Chip. Everyone calls me that," he said to her. "Well then, Chip, is there some aspect of my throwing technique that you would want to point out to me for improvement? But I warn you, I'm throwing rocks into the lake because I'm in a bad mood." No sooner had she said it than she regretted being so transparent. Why had she said that? Chip smiled again, as if she had merely noted that the weather was mild and pleasant. "Oh, that is all well and good," he said. "It might even help with the throwing technique. Give it some welly, then. Here, fire off a couple and I will observe you in action, so that I can make more accurate suggestions for improvement." He folded his arms across his chest, stepped back, and gazed at her, smiling all the while. Vivian noted that he did not ask why she was in a bad mood, an observation that immediately gained him points in her esteem. Any young man who had enough discretion to mind his own business was off to a good start with her. Vivian bent down, picked up another small rock, and then frowned. "What is welly?" she asked. "You know, some effort, some determination," explained Chip. He came to stand behind her right shoulder, and then he pointed forward. "You imagine the head of your enemy at about there, and you let him have it." He stepped away again, picked up another rock, and demonstrated, hurling it into the lake with an enthusiastic cry. He sounded so ridiculous, Vivian had to smile. "Is the accompanying sound also necessary?" she asked. "It may be the most important element, really," laughed Chip. Vivian dropped the rock she had been holding. "In that case, I can just give up now," she said. "Did you just arrive?" Chip nodded. "I often work quite late, so trying to be somewhere before noon on the following day can be a bit challenging." Vivian looked down and kicked at the loose rocks with her shoes. If Chip made any sort of remarks about her first and last visit to his place of employment, she would probably hurl herself into the lake in embarrassment. She had the feeling, however, that he would not stoop so low. "Say, if you are ready to give up this rock-throwing thing, I think the others are getting ready to start lunch. That is, in fact, what I came to tell you." His blonde hair, shiny in the sun, looked like it might fall into his eyes again as he smiled at her. She nodded, unsure of what to say, and walked back with him to where the rest of the group had put blankets down on the ground and where everyone was busy helping themselves to lunch. Vivian took a metal camping plate that someone handed her and started putting her food on it, not very focused on what she was doing. By now, Gregory's ship was underway, and he was sailing further and further from her each minute. What did it matter, since he had never really been hers anyways? Her conscience plagued her, however. Even though things now appeared to be over between them, in gratitude for all of the nice times that they did have, Shouldn't she have gone to the dock to say goodbye? It had been spineless of her to avoid him. The more she thought about it, the more certain she felt that going was what she should have done. After Galatoires and Christmas and the Café du Monde and all those plays and operas, after a ball and tea at his place and all those Wednesday visits, after their declarations of love, what kind of person would just walk away without a thank you or a goodbye? A kind of no-good, rotten person like her. Gregory must be sighing with relief that he had rid himself of an entanglement with someone like her. She sat down with her plate and started to eat, when suddenly a memory of their day alone in Thibodeau came up before her eyes. All of that happiness with him, back when she had still believed in happiness. The tears came up into her eyes before she could stop them. She looked up and caught Nadine looking over at her. Nadine would never be satisfied to leave this alone. She would pry until she had a response, as if Vivian was a reluctant clam. But when Nadine approached her later, as the group finished up the picnic and started out on their hike, she was gentle. The two friends walked side by side, behind the others. "This is the day that Gregory left for his journey, right?" asked Nadine. "Oh, you must be so upset." Vivian merely nodded. "Well, few people have a love like you have with Gregory. I'm certain that after a few days have passed, you will be able to feel him close again in your heart, as if he were right here with you." At these words, Vivian's inner reserve gave way. "Oh, Nadine, you have no idea of the truth. The truth is that we parted on rather bitter terms. We had a falling out and, well, I don't think he treated me with the respect that I deserved, and I was quite bitter about it. And I did not go to see him off at the dock before coming here. For God's sake, don't go and tell anyone all this." Nadine's bottom jaw fell open, and she almost stumbled over an unevenness in the path, so that Vivian had to clutch at her friend's sleeve to steady her. "What do you mean?" she asked. "Are you and Gregory parted, then? Is he no longer your beau?" "Sometimes I wonder if he ever was," said Vivian bitterly. "He told me that he never meant to marry me. What can I add to that?"
"He said that?" asked Nadine,
disbelief and shock coloring her words. "Yes, he did. I cannot imagine why he ever said he wanted to court me. It was his idea, after all. He asked my mother for the permission to court me, and then he asked me. I got so wrapped up in his formal declarations and his handsomeness that I did not think to question him on his motives. I guess I must have trusted him."
"But this makes no sense. There must be a misunderstanding here. Gregory would never do such a thing. What did he actually say? Did he truly and directly say he would never marry you?" asked Nadine.
"Yes, I swear he said that. There was no room for doubt. He also never kissed me. Well, at least not really kissed me, like a real suitor might kiss a woman he loves. He was angry with me for wearing that blouse, by the way. Upset in the way that a father might be. It is not that I felt he did not want me at all, but more that he was fighting with something inside of himself, and that he felt he had to suppress any desire. For a long time, I thought perhaps he just wanted me to be older. But now, I'm wondering if he really just wanted me to be someone else," said Vivian.
"What do you mean? Is this about that woman I saw him coming out of the theater with?"
Nadine turned her head to look more closely at Vivian. "No, this is not about her. It is somebody else. He told me to never enter his bedroom in his apartment, and, well, the night that my mother took your mother to the clinic, I confess I actually broke into his apartment. He was not at home at first."
"Vivian, now you shock me. You broke into his apartment when he wasn't home? You would do such a thing?"
Nadine said in a low voice, lest the others ahead of them overhear.
"I did not want to go back alone in the dark, having come so far already. And once I found his spare key, it seemed like I should use it to go in.
I know this sounds terrible now, but at the time it did not seem so very bad just to go in and wait for him. I went in, walked through the apartment, to see if perhaps he was home, but he had just not heard me at the door. And as I was walking down his hallway, I saw the door to his bedroom partially open, and I walked in. "No," breathed Nadine in a shocked voice. Vivian continued. His bedroom was full of very old furniture, and, well, there was this picture on his dresser, a drawing, really, of a very beautiful woman. She must have either died or said no to him and gone off and married somebody else, or for some other tragic reason they could not be together. And maybe that is the true reason he will not marry, that he feels he cannot fully give his heart to anyone else now, even to me. Nadine looked at her friend with compassion. "This is heartbreaking, Vivian. He must have met you, fallen in love with you, asked to court you, but then the power that this earlier love has over his heart must have reasserted itself. It must have brought him to the point where he questioned if he could love you with as much of his heart as you deserved. Oh, can't you see? He did not want to wrong you, Vivian. How noble of him!"
"Well, that's all fine and dandy, supposing it is true. But from where I sit, someone just let me know that I was not good enough, and then walked out on me," said Vivian bitterly.
"What will you do now? Will you tell your mother?" asked Nadine.
"No, at least not yet. A part of me holds out hope that he will go away, will miss me, and will change his mind, and return from his trip wanting to marry me after all. It is pure girlish foolishness, isn't it?"
"Well, and if this happens, imagine how unlikely it is that my mother will ever let him come calling on me again, after knowing that he broke it off with me already once," replied Vivian.
Nadine frowned, looking back down on the path as they walked. "You have thought all of this through carefully, I see," she said.
"So what happens next, then?"
"I go home and wait to hear from him, I suppose. He told me that he would write," said Vivian.
"Oh, he will write to you, Vivi. The man loves you like mad. Pull yourself together. Nothing is decided yet. Perhaps the blouse was not the best idea, but we will find a way yet for you to win him. He will have time to think everything over, as you say, and then he will be back. And by then, you will be ready to meet him and see if he has changed his mind," said Nadine. She smiled at Vivian. "Don't despair. Things will work themselves out." They stopped. Nadine gave Vivian a hug, and then they walked on faster until they caught up with the rest of the group. The rest of the afternoon was spent in fun and conversation, in which Vivian partook as much as she was able. Someone brought out a ball, and Chip organized an impromptu British football match with humorously pathetic results. Chip laughed and exhorted them enthusiastically to play better, but after Alice and Mabel tripped on each other's skirts and fell over on each other, although the ball was nowhere near them, the hilarity got so wild that it was impossible to continue with the game. Chip threw up his hands and declared them all hopeless, and then suggested that they should go back into town and stop somewhere for a cold beer. Frank said this was the best suggestion anyone had made all day, and so the whole group packed up the picnic items, and they made their way back. Vivian could not imagine sitting around any place and drinking cold beer, so she excused herself and went home. Frank opened his mouth to convince her to come with them, but Nadine put her hand on his arm and he stopped. By the time Vivian arrived back home, the barrier between her and her misery was so thin that it was all she could do to hold herself together in front of her mother. She wanted to have the day to do over again, perhaps the whole past week, perhaps the entire year. How far back would she have to go so that her heart would not hurt right now? To before he came to the hospital? To before the accident? To before Metairie? "You're so quiet tonight, Vivian. Is everything all right?" her mother asked her at dinner.
"I have an upset stomach," lied Vivian. Her mother smiled sympathetically. "Too much picnic food, I see. You did not say much about how the day went. Did you have a nice time?"
"Yes, mother," answered Vivian, I think I will go to bed early tonight. The next few days were rough. Vivian tried to spend as much time out of the house and running errands as was possible, but that only helped to hide her misery, not to lessen it. One evening she came home, and her mother was full of a story about the latest ridiculous garment requested by the much-hated Mrs. Beaufort. But Vivian's attention was suddenly distracted. Something was different here this evening. What was it? Vivian looked around the room. Here on the dining table, there had been flowers. "Where are the flowers?" she asked, her heart suddenly pounding.
"Gregory's flowers? Why, they started to look withered, so I took them outside to the trash."
"I'm sorry. Would you have preferred to throw them out yourself?" "Here, I saved the ribbon for you," replied her mother, handing her the bright polka-dotted green and white ribbon that had held the bouquet together. "I know you are very sad that he had to leave for his travels, but it will all work out. Do not worry. I have a good feeling about everything." Vivian choked on her drink of water. Her mother stared.
That went down the wrong pipe," Vivian explained pathetically.
How ironic that her mother had finally come to call him just Gregory, now that it no longer mattered, now that it was all hopeless, now that there was no more expectation that it could all work out, and now that even the last flowers that she would ever get from him were lying in the building's trash container. Her mother reached over, patted her hand, and began taking the dinner items away to the kitchen. Vivian tried to tell herself that she had to be less maudlin about the entire thing, but then as night fell and she was readying herself for bed, she felt an overwhelming desire not to let Gregory's flowers wither next to other people's discarded chicken bones and other trash, and she raced downstairs and opened the container. Of course, the container was quite full, and since the weather was warm, the smell from the container was chokingly awful. But she could readily find bits of the large bouquet sticking out from among the other trash. Holding her breath, but suddenly unable to hold back her tears, she overcame her revulsion, reached her hands in, and pulled out a number of the flowers, and then she carefully pulled off their petals. This was it, her final memento of him, now that she would never see him again. She hid the petals in her pocket, raced back upstairs, hoped her mother had not noticed her lengthier absence, and then she quickly finished up in the washroom in the hallway. Back in the apartment, she waited until her mother had stepped out to ready herself for bed, before pulling the petals out and wrapping them in a handkerchief and hiding it in her private drawer. She would rather die 1,000 deaths than admit to anyone that she had saved these flower petals from Gregory's bouquet. What sensible person would do such a thing? She hated herself for her sense of vulnerability, and she blamed Gregory. If he had not treated her so badly, she would not have been driven to this pathetic display of emotion. Well, at least nobody knew about it. Her mother came back, turned out the lights, and went to bed, and Vivian clutched her pillow in the dark like a drowning victim might cling to a life preserver, as hot tears poured down her face, and she sobbed as quietly as she knew how. In the morning, she awoke with new strength and resolved that she must not let her mother know of what had passed between her and Gregory before his departure. Since he was not going to come calling for the foreseeable future, and possibly ever again, as long as she kept her mouth closed, not much could leak out that she did not wish to share. Unhelpfully, her mother interpreted her silence as heartache over Gregory's absence, and to buoy Vivian's feelings, she began to speak of how wonderful Gregory was and where he might be in his journey by now, and when Vivian might receive a letter from him. Every day, when the mail was delivered to the mail slots downstairs, Vivian would rush down to be the first to see their mail slot's contents. She told herself that she was just trying to keep her mother from seeing it if there happened to be a letter or postcard from Gregory. But as the days wore on, a growing part of her genuinely longed for him to write to her. She began to fervently dream of a letter in which he apologized, changed his mind about marrying her, and told her how much he loved her. Every day now, the known rational part of her brain fought with this new, entirely unreasonable part of her brain, and it started to weaken and to change her. She started to carry around his copy of Bullfinch's Mythology, and even started trying to read it again more studiously. In the second week since his departure, she found her feelings becoming less hurt, and the sharp bitterness of their last exchanges began to soften. Maybe not all was lost. He would write to her, and they would find their way forward to the kind of mutual goals and affection that would heal their friendship. She lay in bed, looked up at the ceiling in the darkness, tried to recall as best as she could the passionate writings she had seen in his private journal, and she imagined what he would write to her now. All of that passion could not possibly have been faked. In the third week, impatient to hear from him, she went out to the paper supplies store and purchased a small sheaf of loose paper, on which she determined she would begin writing to him. She did not have an address to send anything to, of course, but she could always share her letters with him later. Now she just wanted to have a place for her feelings to flow out, where her mother could not see them. Her first letter was exactly 4 sentences long. "I miss you, Gregory," she wrote. And then she had ended with, "I hope you are having a good time on your trip." She looked down at what she had written, and her mind inevitably drew the comparison between the pages and pages of passionate outpourings that he had crafted in his unmistakable, elegant handwriting, and this ugly, stunted thing that she had created, her childish letters obviously shaped by the hand of a second-rate schoolgirl. No wonder he did not want her, she thought. She could still hear Anastasia calling her a small pet bunny. No doubt the lady that he had truly loved had been a fantastic sculler, and 1,000 times more resplendent and graceful even than Anastasia, and they had exchanged exquisite, artistic letters together. To come from that to this was several steps down for him, certainly. She thought about crumpling up what she had written, but then she stuck out her chin, told herself that she could probably sew circles around his former love, and that it was better to show that she had cared and tried than to have no record one day of ever having written him anything at all. She put the paper and pen away in her private drawer and sighed. For the next couple of days, she wrote a little bit each day, writing what she had done, not much, and what she had seen and heard, nothing exciting. Writing was very hard, quite uncomfortable, and Nadine had better not find out about this new hobby or she would insist on knowing what Vivian had written. As it happened, though, Nadine was rather busy suddenly, and there was little time for confidences. Nadine's mother had spent 2 months on and off at the clinic, while Nadine kept house mostly alone in their apartment. But it turned out that Nadine was also keeping some secrets. Frank was a much more frequent visitor than Nadine let on, a fact that became apparent when Nadine's mother stopped going to the clinic. To Vivian's surprise, Nadine actually complained and sulked. It took some probing to determine that Nadine had become accustomed to a great deal of freedom with her beau, spending late evenings out with him and letting him spend much time alone with her in her apartment. Nadine's mother was shocked to find how far things had advanced since she had had her focus pulled away by her own troubles. And as if to make up for lost time, she angrily put down new rules about when Nadine had to be home in the evenings, how often Frank could come by and visit, and how much alone time they could have. Nadine rebelled. She shouted at her mother that she had managed just fine while her mother was away, and that she had long run the household and managed the budget, and that she was a grown woman and would not submit to the same kind of rules that her mother had insisted on before, and that Frank was going to come as often as Nadine wanted him to. Instead of coming to Vivian with her troubles, as she might have in the past, Nadine sought her consolation with Frank, suddenly leaving Vivian more alone than she had been in years. In the end, things at the Dinard household became so strained that Vivian's mother intervened because she feared that Nadine's mother would turn to the bottle again to find relief from her troubles, unless a new peace could be reestablished in the household. From Nadine's living room, Vivian overheard her mother speaking with Nadine's mother in the kitchen and saying, "It's no good to fight it. We have to accept that these girls are growing up in a different time, and things are more difficult in many ways than we had them. They grow up faster now, but that is not necessarily so bad. Frank is a kind and responsible young man, from all I have heard, and he has a good job, which is more than many men have these days. You have to trust her a little bit more now, that is all." This line of reasoning went down well and things improved, at least until the day that Nadine's mother came home and found her daughter in a state of advanced undress and in a passionate embrace with Frank. The fortunate fact that Frank was fully clothed was his saving grace, and Nadine's mother only screamed and threw him out rather than attempting to kill him, or so Nadine explained, between sobs to Vivian. Vivian was still in shock that her friend would consider letting her beau undress her. Then, after a few moments, she realized. Her shock was more anger that her friend had let things get so out of hand. And then, after a few more minutes, she realized that what she really felt was a deep and destructive jealousy. Frank wanted Nadine in the way that Gregory did not want Vivian, clearly. If Gregory had wanted Vivian and had wanted to passionately embrace her the night that she had come into his apartment, wouldn't she have let him do as he wished with her? Hadn't she told him as much? No suggestions of undressing had been made, although the words "cold bath" had been said. Meanwhile, Nadine was well on her way to having a real lover. The chasm that was thus created between the two girls was a second devastation to Vivian, who had already gone through a painful loss a month earlier with Gregory. She sat by the dining table alone. Her mother was out. The afternoon was overcast and ugly, and she tried to write to him again, although he had still not written to her. "It has been 33 days since you left," she wrote. "At first, I was very angry with you. I wanted you to admit that you had treated me badly, and I wanted your apology. Then Nadine left me to spend all of her time with Frank. Now that I am all alone and with plenty of time to think everything over, I'm feeling less sure that I want to dislike you. I am trying to read more of Bullfinch's mythology, but it is slow going. Most of the time, I just hold it and touch its cover, which is probably stupid, but it is all I have. What are you doing in Europe? Is everything well? Why have you not written to me, or have you sent me things and they have been lost by the post? Every day since we fought is the worst day of the year, and I want to go back and unsay things we said to each other. I do not sleep well these days. I wake up from dreams in which I am running and looking for you everywhere. How foolish of me. I feel terrible." Well, this was even worse than the other letters she had started, she reflected,
rereading her sentences to herself. He had probably not written to her because he did not want to write to her, that was why. And there was nothing more to be said. She stood up and walked to the window. Is this what the man who read Cyrano to her would do at the end of a friendship? Would he just vanish? No, he would never even consider it, the voice in her heart whispered. Even if she had been dreadful to him and had stupidly refused to see him off at the dock. Are you certain he would not consider? Asked the voice in her head as if in answer. She did not know Gregory very much at all, she suddenly realized. A year later, and she still did not truly know what kind of a man he was. Her mother was not insensitive to Vivian's plight, seeing her get a little more crushed with every passing day when there was nothing in the mail for her, and seeing Nadine's visits become fewer and briefer. They had gone into town to see the parades on the 4th of July, and now, to cheer her up again, her mother suggested a walk around to Canal Street and then the French Quarter to look in all of the boutique windows. These days, even formerly rich ladies indulged in window shopping far more frequently than in actual shopping, and this hobby often resulted in new business for Vivian and her mother, as they were commissioned to remake old skirts and dresses into more stylish looks, inspired by seeing the cuts and patterns of new and unaffordable dresses hanging on mannequins in shop windows. "This is necessary for our work," said her mother, with mock serious face as they strolled through the streets in the summer sun. As a special treat, she had bought croissants for the two of them to share, and they nibbled on their respective baked treats slowly and appreciatively. "Oh, look at this one," said her mother, pointing to a dress on display, and Vivian looked, but her mind was back in Gregory's apartment, and she was looking up at him, glorious, glorious Gregory, shining like a saint, but glowing with the rough appeal of the most unrepentantly sensual sinner. Vivian. Vivian! You're walking with your eyes open, but I do believe you are daydreaming. Come here. Let us sit down for a bit on this bench. It is hot enough to melt the pavement today. I do not wish to pry, but I can see that you are deeply unhappy. Something happened between you and Gregory before he left. You said he did or said something to hurt you? Asked her mother gently. Here it was, the conversation which she had been avoiding for weeks. I'm not sure anymore if he loves me, said Vivian. And she was surprised as the words came out how much relief it brought her to say it out loud to someone.
Well, I can set you straight there, said her mother. He does love you, without a doubt.
Something is not right, though. Vivian sighed and looked at the ground, knowing full well it was a bad habit of hers when she was flustered and feeling stupid for it. He is very unusual, and, well, now he does not think he will ever marry, and I rather hope that we would.
Her mother looked at her as if what Vivian had just said was the least surprising statement ever made.
We all know Gregory is unusual, she said, and as for whether he will ever marry, do you believe his intention is to merely have a dalliance with you? I would think he is much too upright for that. The truth is that many men, even the decent ones, have a mental aversion to marriage. He is older than you, but he is still a young man, and many young men struggle with the idea of settling down to a bride and a family with children. Perhaps you are not the only one who still needs to mature and become wiser. Just because he is older and taller and knows more about the theater does not mean he is flawless and he has swallowed the entire wisdom of the universe. Give him the freedom to be wrong in this, and to change his mind. Vivian sighed. I'm not sure he will ever change, she said. Everyone changes, said her mother sadly, after a pause.
Your father thought that he could face marriage and a wife and a child, and then changed his mind in the opposite direction,
to realize he couldn't. Everyone should think carefully and determine what he or she is capable of. Perhaps your father and I should have been more hesitant, like your beau, only we were so in love that we rushed into things, more like Nadine.
Tell me again, was it a great love? Asked Vivian shyly, always careful when she was talking to her mother about what the love had been like that had been between her and Vivian's father.
It was a great miscalculation, said her mother.
But I got you out of the entire experience, so that has changed my memories of it. I'm not as bitter about it as I would otherwise have been.
Was it a very passionate love? Asked Vivian,
remembering Frank and Nadine kissing enthusiastically behind the tree in the park.
Passion is usually not the problem, said her mother. Your father was very passionate. He was every unreasonable impulse rolled into one person. Sometimes I think his whole life was lived on the spur of the moment. He swept me away, and I left behind all of my common sense. You may judge Nadine's mother harshly today for speaking firmly with Nadine about the incident with Frank, but I look back and sometimes wish that someone had stepped in for me and spoken some sense to me before I agreed to marry your father. Youth is a trial of sorts, and I know that it is difficult for you also, with Gregory gone, and with difficulties arising in your friendship with him, and you feel that you have lost Nadine at the same time, but you have not lost them. Things are only changing, that's all, and they will change again, and in a little bit, everything will be different yet again. After your father left, I put my entire heart into raising you and loving you and doing the best for you that I could. Be patient, have courage, and things will come out the way they should in the end.
Do you believe that they came out the way they should for you? Asked Vivian in a small voice.
Her mother looked at her and smiled. Actually, yes, I believe that they did. And you should know that this is not the end. Rather, the moment that someone's shiny exterior begins to crack, you can actually begin to see inside. It means you are getting closer to something real. People are not all smooth and shiny and perfect. Even people with perfectly brilliantined hair, like Gregory Morgan. And I, for one, am heartened to hear that he is a fallible mortal, because I had begun to worry a little bit. She gave a small laugh, and then they both finished their croissants, and her mother gave her a hug before they continued on their way.
They were passing in front of the Cabildo on Jackson Square when Vivian suddenly and unexpectedly heard a male voice calling. Miss Vivian! Miss Vivian! She looked around, and there in the crowd was a familiar blonde head. It was Chip Westcott, wearing tan trousers and a light tan-colored suit jacket. His tan hat with its wide brim was in his hand, and he was waving it. Who is this? Asked her mother. One of your friends? Vivian started to answer, but by this time Chip had reached them, and introductions were at hand. Vivian gave Chip what she hoped looked to be a credible, relaxed smile, took a deep breath, and dived into the formalities.
Mother, may I present Mr. Chester Westcott? He is a friend of ours, and Nadine and I met him through Frank. Mr. Westcott, may I present my mother, Mrs. Prevett? They shook hands, and Chip bowed slightly, as if playfully making light of the gesture. His face was beaming, and his eyes were full of sparkle.
Now that she was feeling rotten herself, it was rather annoying.
Vivian wondered if he had ever known a glum day. It is a great pleasure to make your acquaintance, Mrs. Prevett, said Chip. My friends know me as Chip. Vivian had forgotten how thrilling to her ears his exotic foreign accent was. Her mother had not expected an accent and was visibly surprised. "I always enjoy meeting Vivian's friends," Vivian's mother said. "But you are not from around these parts, I take it."
"No, indeed, ma'am. I'm from Sheffield, in South Yorkshire, you know, like the pudding," Chip said.
"Well, as I live and breathe, I have never met a British person before. Vivian, you did not tell me that you had such cosmopolitan friends," said her mother, smiling.
"Ah, I see I have made a deep impact on Miss Prevett. She has clearly spoken of me often," Chip laughed. "Well, no matter. When I was getting ready to sail over here, someone told me that American ladies are in awe of a British accent. But so far, my experience has been that American ladies are rather no-nonsense and not that easily impressed. Smart Miss Prevett is no exception." Here Chip smiled again, a dazzling smile that could not fail to charm the most no-nonsense lady in Louisiana. Vivian wondered if Gregory had ever smiled so widely and so easily in his life, and whether he had ever brilliantly smiled as many times in a single day as Chip managed to do in each casual hour.
"What are you doing about town today, Miss Prevett?" asked Chip, turning to face her directly. "We are taking an afternoon off and looking at shop windows," said Vivian.
"Oh, so it is a pleasure outing. Well, I would not want to get in the way of anyone's pursuit of life, liberty, or happiness, as you Americans put it, and especially not on an afternoon off. So I shall push off and leave you to your leisure," said Chip.
"Where were you headed just now?" asked Vivian, surprising herself that she was curious about this.
"Me? I was just coming from a visit with a chap who showed me the Indian Scout motorcycle that he has for sale. And I'm now going out for a cup of tea and a pastry. Around 4 or 5 in the afternoon, the desire for a cuppa gets overwhelming."
"Say, Mrs. Prevett, would you and Miss Prevett care to join me?"
Chip put out the question casually, but with a smile that no one could have possibly said no to.
"Tea sounds wonderful, as long as it's iced tea," said Vivian's mother. "Don't you think it is much too hot to consider drinking boiling water for refreshment on a day like today?"
Chip laughed heartily.
"In British India, when the days are the hottest and most humid, the chaps in the civil service climb down off their elephants, collapse in the shade of the nearest tree, and ask their servants to bring them hot afternoon tea. Even the idea of tea with ice is most exotic to a true Brit."
"But doesn't hot tea on a day like today just make you more uncomfortable?" asked Vivian.
"Come and have tea with me and find out," winked Chip. Then he clapped his hands and gave an excited hoot. "Oh, and I have just the place in mind. Iced tea for the Americans and hot tea for the Briton, then followed by sandwiches. This will work out perfectly."
"We have only a short bit of time left in our afternoon, Mr. Westcott," said Vivian's mother. "I hope you will not think us rude if we can stay for the tea only."
"Not at all, ma'am. I would be content with even 30 minutes of your company," replied Chip. "Follow me."
They walked on through the crowd together and did not have far to go before they reached their destination, a shaded courtyard cafe, where Chip pointed out a table. They sat down. Chip ordered their teas, and Vivian's mother reached into her handbag and pulled out a small oriental folding fan.
She waved it in front of her face, frowning. "I think I'm just shifting the humidity around in front of my face," she confessed.
"Oh, the luxury of an iced tea on a day like today. It is a splurge for us, Vivian, but do let's enjoy it thoroughly."
"I hope you would not offend me by not allowing me to pay for your teas. No young man in Sheffield would dream of inviting ladies out for tea and then telling them to pay their own way. No, indeed," said Chip in mock horror.
"Is Sheffield a place of great refinement, then?" asked Vivian.
She knew nothing of Sheffield, only that New Orleans apparently imported barmen from there.
"Oh, Sheffield is very refined," Chip said. "Sheffield Cathedral is over 500 years old. The whole place has an aura of high class and antiquity."
"I always wanted to be able to voyage overseas one day," Vivian's mother admitted.
"But tell us, what makes a young man like yourself want to come over here?
in the other direction, to America.
Chip took on the question eagerly and without any hesitation.
Well, Sheffield is wonderful, but it is not exactly an oasis of opportunity for an up-and-coming entrepreneur.
Are you an entrepreneur? Asked Vivian's mother.
Indeed I am, said Chip proudly. A couple of blokes and I decided that we want to get ourselves set up in a business of our own, a kind of import-export business, and so we decided to come to a major port city in America. One of us said it should be New York, another of us said San Francisco, and the third one wanted New Orleans. We decided San Francisco was much too far, and then we tossed the coin to decide between New York and New Orleans. New Orleans won.
Which one did you want to go to? Asked Vivian. New Orleans?
No, laughed Chip. I was one of the disappointed ones. My vote was always for New York, a real man's city. But now that we are here in New Orleans, I'm coming to enjoy it quite a bit.
The waiter came with their teas, giving Chip a puzzled raised eyebrow as he put the hot tea in front of him.
You know, you could have just ordered iced tea like the rest of us, waited 10 minutes, and the weather today would turn it into the steaming cup you have in front of you now, suggested Vivian.
Who has 10 minutes? Hooted Chip. As an entrepreneur, my time is very precious.
Time is money, as you say in America.
And what is it exactly that you spend most of your time doing, Mr. Westcott? Asked Vivian's mother.
Well, we are setting up our import-export business, and everything is going according to plan. We filled out the needed paperwork, and now are starting to make inroads over at the docks to see how best to set up the logistics for transport, replied Chip.
What are logistics? Asked Vivian, taking a sip of her iced tea and imagining that this is what heaven must be like.
It is a kind of technical term that only businessmen in the trade know. It has to do with getting items onto ships, and then off of them and into the hands of paying customers. But I don't want to bore you ladies with the details, said Chip affably.
On the contrary, it sounds very interesting. And may I ask what it is that you will import and export? Asked Vivian's mother.
Chip took another sip, set down his cup, smiled again, and said,
Oh, this and that. Many things, actually, to support the restaurant and foods trade. Restaurant supplies, boxed beverages, tablecloths, and such. It takes up much of my time corresponding with our business partners back in Sheffield, who are helping to arrange the shipment of these items here.
How interesting, said Vivian's mother. I had no idea that there was a market in New Orleans for British tablecloths. And what would you export back to Sheffield?
Pipe tobacco, maize, sugar cane syrup, sometimes dried nuts. In short, all those things that Louisiana has in full supply that do not grow very well in a northern land like Great Britain, replied Chip.
Do you have an office that you go to? Asked Vivian's mother.
Oh, yes, I do. My business partners and I meet regularly to hold meetings and to direct our enterprise.
It takes up most of my time, actually.
Here, Chip looked over at Vivian. He had said nothing so far about working as a bartender, and Vivian was wondering if he would make mention of it. Perhaps he was afraid that her mother might disapprove of someone who worked in the alcohol trade. Vivian, however, suddenly felt no compunction to hold up his disguise.
"Do you not also work in town as a barman?" she asked with a smile.
"There, now let's see how wide your smile goes."
Chip looked sheepish, but only for about 1 second.
One of our friends in town owns a bar and needs help on busy evenings, and, well, I do not need to tell you that an entrepreneur starting out in business could always do with more funds for investment. I make myself useful, I do, but I would not want you to think that just because I help my friend there, that I myself overindulge.
Here he looked over at Vivian, smiling lightly, but nonetheless making his point. Vivian blushed and looked away. Her mother must not have noticed, because she merely said,
"Well, you sound like a very industrious young man, looking to make something of himself in this world, and that is all to the good. It is most kind of you to invite us for tea. Vivian, hasn't it been a lovely treat?"
"Yes, very much so," said Vivian, and they sat in silence for a few more minutes until Vivian dared to look up again. Chip was smiling over at her in the friendliest manner, as if to say, "I only meant it in jest. Do not be sore at me." Her mother was just finishing her tea. Chip paid the waiter, stood up, jumped to get Vivian's mother's chair, helped Vivian up also, confidently slipped her arm through his, and then they followed Vivian's mother and walked back out onto the street, where he let go of Vivian and they all paused. "I do not want to be too forward," said Chip, "but it would be very nice to be able to call on you again, Miss Prevett. Would that suit you also?" Vivian was quiet for a while. Was it proper for someone with another beau to accept such an invitation? Did she still have another beau? She was suddenly upset that he had been so bold as to touch her. "Maybe when the group goes out again for a picnic or a visit to the movies," she finally said. "I see," said Chip. "I suppose I should have asked. Are you spoken for?" "Yes," said Vivian hastily. She could not believe that he would be so bold as to ask her something like this in front of her mother. This Chester Westcott was definitely fearless. Vivian suddenly wanted to be home already and out of this uncomfortable conversation.
"Well, you cannot stop a chap from dreaming," Chip laughed. "I understand. Have a wonderful rest of the day, and I will continue to roam the streets of New Orleans in the hope that we will run into each other like this again."
He shook hands with both of them, put his hat back on so that it shaded his brilliantly blue eyes, and then with a last jovial wave, he was gone.
"That was an interesting young man," said her mother. "Tell me, Vivian, are all of your young gentlemen friends so terribly handsome?"
"It appears so," said Vivian, without cracking a smile. Chip may have been the handsomest man left in New Orleans, now that Gregory had gone. But Vivian knew she did not want Chip, and the memory of his smiles and the brilliance of his golden hair in the sun only made her long more despairingly for the one whom she did love. "Let's go home," she said, not wanting to talk any further about Chip with her mother. In the dark, once she was in bed, she was thinking back on the day when a sudden horrible realization came over her. When they had walked out of the cafe, she had walked out into the street on Chip's arm. Wasn't this exactly identical to Gregory's situation when Nadine had seen him with Anastasia? How inconsolably hurt and betrayed she had felt. And now here she was, having done the same thing, just as innocently and unwittingly. She remembered how difficult she had made it for Gregory and how much guilt she had laid on him over the incident. This would have been the same situation, but with the shoe on the other foot, if Gregory had seen them walk out into the street like that this afternoon. And the thought filled her with terrible shame and remorse. She reached out for his book in the dark and held it carefully while she cried and cried.
Maybelle had a grandmother who had a house with a small yard out in Metairie, and in late July, the group of friends decided to go out there to spend the afternoon. Chip brought a crate of beer bottles, a truck delivered a slab of ice. Frank and Louis pulled all of the cushions off of Maybelle's grandmother's sofas and carried out all of her chairs and her dining table, and in this way, a pleasant seating area was readied in the yard under the trees. Louis's friend William and another boy named Harden had joined them this time. Harden was soft-spoken and had huge brown eyes that, Vivian could see, Alice had a difficult time not staring at with her mouth hanging open. Helen and Mary were laying blankets down on the grass when Vivian arrived with Nadine, and Frank welcomed them and asked Nadine if she would help cook the sausages. Frank left them, and Vivian followed Nadine into the small old kitchen, where it was already hot enough to cook sausages without the need of a stove. Nadine opened the small kitchen window, wiped her brow, and sighed. "Imagine what it must be like now in Maine," she said. "Gentle summers, a crisp breeze every minute, and meanwhile we stew here like shrimp etouffee." She looked out of the window. "Oh, look, Chip got a haircut. It's nice." "I asked Frank to get his haircut. He is starting to look like a rail yard hobo." "I still cannot believe you haven't heard anything from Gregory yet. It has been almost 2 months." Vivian turned her face away, under the guise of searching for cooking implements in the cabinets and drawers. "I do not think I will. He may not be back, you know." "What nonsense, Vivi. Something must have happened. Not to him, no, nothing serious, but something with the mail. I know he has written to you. And of course he will come back, if for no other reason than because he has an entire apartment full of his belongings here in New Orleans," said Nadine. "The man owns 800 acres of land out by Thibodeau," grumbled Vivian. "I'm sure he could easily replace a couple of sofas, cabinets, and an old bedroom set." Nadine stopped fussing with the kitchen curtains and turned to Vivian. "Are you in earnest?" she asked. Then Vivian realized that she had never told Nadine this fact. What should she do now? Should she lie about it? Why lie, as if his being wealthy required her protection to cover it up? "Yes, he owns the land that his horses are stabled on, and all the buildings on the farm. The Mullins are his tenants." "How long have you known this, and why did you never tell me before?" asked Nadine, wide-eyed.
"Well, you and I do not exactly talk all that often anymore," began Vivian, but then her voice trailed away. "I will not show how bitter I am about how things have become," she thought. "What good would it do?"
At that moment, Mabel came into the kitchen.
"Ah, Nadine! Vivian! Glad to see you are finding your way about the place. I made a cold salad with cooked potatoes and put it in the icebox, and the pickles are in there, too. And Grandma made us a pot of rice and mirepoix here on the stove. Can I help with the sausages?"
"Where is your grandmother while we take over her house?" asked Vivian.
"She would not agree to let us have this gathering here until my mother promised to take her out to the salon for a new permanent wave. She's a fussy old bat. You should have heard her negotiating. It had to be a special salon, not the usual place where she gets her hair set. And she insisted that my mother cook her fried chicken for lunch, and that for the rest of the afternoon she would get the seat closest to the electric fan," said Mabel.
"Oh, that's the kind of old lady that I'm going to be when I get older," said Nadine with a grin. "Quick, somebody warn Frank," laughed Mabel.
The attention shifted to the cooking of sausages, but Nadine's curiosity was lit, and as the other girls came in to help carry the dishes out to the yard, she returned to the subject of Gregory's wealth.
"How is it that Gregory comes to own 800 acres and a farm and horses? What made him buy that particular land?" asked Nadine, once they were alone in the kitchen again.
"I'm not certain that he bought it," said Vivian. "I think he inherited it. He never wanted to talk about the past, but I think his family must have been from a higher class of society. His mother had a gardener, he had a pony to ride as a boy, you know, things like that."
"I do not ever think that he had a typical Louisiana accent," said Nadine, wrinkling her brow with the effort of trying to remember.
"He has a slightly unusual accent. He pronounces some words a bit oddly at times. I don't know why that is. But he did once say that his father was born in New York City, so maybe that explains it," replied Vivian.
"What a catch for a husband, though, Vivi. A man who owns 800 acres, regardless of how exactly he came by them, could take such good care of you and any children, even when times are so difficult and so uncertain," said Nadine thoughtfully.
"Yes, it is all good with the 800 acres, but you are conveniently leaving out the part where he said he would never marry me or have children with me, and then he left," Vivian reminded her.
"You really believe this?" asked Nadine. Every day that he is gone and I hear nothing from him, I believe it more, Vivian confessed. For the record, and in case there are any doubts about this later, he broke faith with me, not I with him.
Frank came into the kitchen at that point, put his arm around Nadine's waist, kissed her, and told her she had done a wonderful job with the sausages and that if she didn't hurry, Chip and William would inhale them all. They walked out into the blinding sunshine and into the happy buzz of the party. Chip waved over at Vivian and smiled. His hair was no longer falling in his eyes. It was cut short and was combed down with more care than he had taken on any previous occasion. He looked older, even more self-assured and more handsome. Not like Gregory or anything, but still. Vivian helped herself to the lunch items, chose iced tea instead of cold beer, sat down next to Alice, and tried to focus on her food. Alice began telling her about the new dog that her neighbors had gotten, but Vivian's attention kept being pulled to the humorous anecdote that Chip was telling across the table to some of the others about his early language misunderstandings when he first arrived in New Orleans. Alice finished up her story, and soon everyone was listening to Chip and laughing. He had a similar non-stop salesman storyteller style to the one that Mr. Bosco had exhibited, thought Vivian, and then the memory of Mr. Bosco made her shiver. The heat and humidity of the afternoon was ruthless. Their clothing got all damp and clammy. Helen suggested that they serve the bread pudding dessert with iced coffee instead of hot, and everyone agreed, although that took longer because they had to wait for the coffee to cool. Chip pulled out a bottle of rum from somewhere on his person and said that that would be a great addition to the coffee, and after that, the party took a decidedly mellow turn. Between the large lunch, the heat and humidity of the day, and the final blow delivered by the rum, the energy level of the party flagged. The partygoers lounged under the trees, lying on the blanket, listening to the buzz of insects, and participated in a greatly slowed pace of conversation. After the third or fourth time that the rum bottle came around, Frank pulled Nadine into his arms and held her close, although they were surrounded by everyone else. Then Lewis reached for Mary's hand, and Alice started whispering with Harden. Even William closed his eyes and made no complaint when Maybelle started running her hand through his hair. The air was one of sedation, not of seduction, and before long the partygoers all began to doze. Vivian closed her eyes, head woolly with the foreign taste of rum, and she focused on the tickling sensation along the back of her neck as the sweat rolled down it. After about 5 minutes had passed, she felt some movement near her, but it was from far away that she felt herself being shifted, and then her head came to rest against a warm shoulder, and a hand brushed lightly against her upper back. A sense of overwhelming relief and comfort swept over her, and, unawares, she moved herself closer to the source of the happy glow. She could hear Gregory's voice suddenly, as if he had just spoken to her, as if he was not a million miles away, as if they had never fought or disagreed about anything, and what he said was one word, the most magical word that she knew, the word that only he used, ancient and sacred and passionate. Beloved. She closed her eyes tighter and sighed with contentment. When her eyelids fluttered open again, there were quiet voices speaking near her. Some of the party had begun to awaken from their afternoon nap, and small conversations were restarting. "That means I am not dead, and therefore cannot be in heaven with Gregory," she thought with disappointment. Yet she still felt the warm shoulder beneath her ear. She shifted herself up on her arm and saw that it was Chip.
that he was asleep, and that somehow they had come to rest against each other. And although it had been harmless, she blushed and hurriedly turned to stand up. Nadine opened her eyes. "Where are you going, Vivi?" she said quietly.
I think I need to go inside for a minute and get some water," said Vivian.
Inside of her head was a slow drumbeat of shameful thoughts. Why had he pulled her close to him? Why had it felt so good? How could she have enjoyed this resting against him when she had no business to enjoy it? What would Gregory say? Well, what right did Gregory have to say anything? Would Gregory ever say anything to her again? She would wait another couple of weeks, and if he could not bring himself to write to her 2.5 months later, then surely it was a sign that he did not mean to ever reach out again. And if he did not come home by the end of August, as he had said that he would, then she was free to do whatever she wished. And what did she wish? She poured herself a glass of water from the kitchen sink, was disgusted to find out that it was entirely warm, but forced herself to swallow it down. She looked out of the kitchen window. What did she wish? What did she want? She wanted what she had always wanted. For Gregory to come back and to tell her that he loved her and that they could be together the way she had always dreamed of. She still wanted the impossible. She finished her drink, rinsed the glass, and was shuffling at the kitchen counter and looking for the kitchen towel so that she could dry the glass when Chip came in. Ah, he has come to apologize, thought Vivian immediately, and she set down the glass and straightened her spine in preparation for what he had to say. "Hello again, Miss Vivian," he said with his easy smile. "I thought to help you by bringing in these," he continued, setting a stack of plates and utensils from lunch onto the kitchen counter. She had not even noticed that he was carrying something when he had first walked in. Vivian was surprised. She had been expecting some sort of apology or even defense or counterattack from him, but not a pile of dishes.
"Certainly, of course, thank you. You can put them over there, next to the sink."
Chip set down the dishes.
"Shall I bring the other things out there in also?" he asked,
and his ever-eager smile gave the impression that even if he had an endless choice of things to do right at that moment, he would have as his first choice the carrying in of dirty dishes for her. It was so charming, despite its unreality, that for a moment she almost believed that it gave him a sense of delight to do this boring household task.
"I did not come inside to do the dishes, but certainly it would be helpful," said Vivian. "Then I will bring them in. I would love to make myself useful."
He stepped out and returned shortly with another stack of dishes, and then another.
"You know what would be useful would be if you washed them all now," said Vivian, eyeing the quite large pile of dishes, cups, and utensils stacked up on the counter. "Was this one all hat and no cowboy? Let him prove it, then. Anyone could carry in a few dishes."
Chip eyed the pile skeptically.
"Oh, that would require going beyond usefulness to flat-out self-sacrifice, I fear."
"You mean you think you cannot do it?" Vivian asked him.
"Oh, I can do it all right, and with the most cheerful demeanor that you have ever seen anyone bring to such work," he replied, in his fascinating accent, leaving the R of the word work oddly silent.
"Then do it," Vivian challenged him. Chip looked back at the pile of dishes, hesitated for a moment, and then turned back to Vivian and smiled.
"All right," he said, "but only if you stay. If I'm going to be miserable, I will require enjoyable company."
So this was his plan. She hesitated, then nodded, and then, since all the chairs had been taken out, she hopped up on the counter and sat down.
"How shall you amuse me, then?" she asked.
"Oh, I had rather hoped that you would amuse me, since I'm the one working here, but very well. We can do it your way. While I wash up,
I shall teach you an old sea shanty that I learned back in Sheffield. Chip smiled, turning on the water and filling up the sink.
Is Sheffield near the sea? Asked Vivian. She had not thought that it was.
Hardly, replied Chip, but our favorite teacher at junior school was from Grimsby. When he came to the end of his patience with us once and lost his temper, our education was vastly expanded from a vocabulary perspective. He had worked for years in the fishing trade while studying to become a school teacher, and it made for an interesting combination.
Chip began moving a pile of dishes and glasses through from suds to rinsing. He worked fast, Vivian saw. Shall I help you rinse? She asked him.
Chip gave her a sarcastic expression with one eyebrow raised. I work in a bar, you know. Do you have any idea how much rinsing and drying of glasses I do? No, sit right there and let me amuse you, as we agreed.
Hello there, said Nadine, who had just come into the kitchen, yawning. Why are you washing the dishes, Chip?
Oh, hello there, Miss Nadine. I am washing all of these dishes on a dare from Miss Vivian, who imagined that I would shrink back in fear from real work. Ah, but she has underestimated me. She also requested that I amuse her, so I was just beginning a funny story that I once heard about a drunk fishmonger in Grimsby who tried to juggle 6 frozen haddock fillets after taking on a wager from a fellow down at the pub. But first, can one of you ladies please hand me the tea towel?
The tea towel? Is that something special that you brought with you today? Asked Nadine, puzzled.
No, you know, just the tea towel to dry the dishes, said Chip.
I think he means the kitchen towel, said Vivian to Nadine.
Ah, he must think he's better than us to use such fancy English, said Nadine. Here it is.
She handed Chip the towel, and he took it with thanks.
So tell us, how does one juggle frozen haddock? She asked, as she joined Vivian on the counter.
Chip launched into his tale, flipping spoons through the air to illustrate his story, and soon both Nadine and Vivian were laughing loudly. Their laughter drifted through the open window and drew others in to join them, and soon everyone was awake and talking, and the party was back in full swing.
Vivian asked Chip to tell another story, and then another. And then when he finished the one after that, he turned to her, folded up the dish towel, and placed it in her lap, and smiled.
You mean you won't tell us another one? She asked him.
I mean that I have finished, ma'am, he said suddenly somberly, and he turned and walked out of the kitchen. Vivian was astounded. Every dish was cleaned, rinsed, dried, and neatly stacked. She had never even noticed when he had gotten any work in. Yes, he was right. He was not just an irresponsible jokester of a barman. She had underestimated him. The rest of the afternoon and into the early evening, she kept sneaking glances at him, trying to figure him out. But he did not come to speak to her again. The young people would have been glad to stay together longer, but Maybell said that her grandmother would be home soon, so everything had to be carried back inside, and the friends began to disperse. Vivian went home tired from the day. The next day, when the mail came, Vivian ran down to pick it up, but still there was nothing from Gregory. It was getting so close to the end of August that even if he had written, it was likely he would return before she would get a letter from him, if he returned at all. She pulled out her loose paper and her pen and unleashed her anger on the empty page. Why did you tell me that you would write to me, that you were thinking of a way for us to keep in touch? Why tell me that when you planned all along to write me nothing? I wouldn't have even been so disappointed if you had not gotten my hopes up first. Now you are just about back from your trip, so I can give up expecting to hear from you. One day, you will read this letter and be hit in the head by the size of my hurt and disappointment. I really believed in you. I was such a child. If you haven't written me yet, do not bother with it any more. I do not need to hear from you. You do not love me, anyways.
Then she threw the paper and pen back in the drawer and slammed it shut. September came, and still no word from Gregory. Nor had he or Wolfgang Gerstner returned. The book repair shop remained closed, as she saw when she intentionally went past it one evening, only now the sign in the window said, "Owner is ill," instead of "closed for vacation," and she wondered what that meant, since she hadn't heard from Gregory that they had returned, and since the lights above the store in Wolfgang Gerstner's apartment remained dark. The realization that Gregory would not write to her was devastating, but the gnawing new fear that he was not coming back was far worse. Depending on her mood, she either worried that something bad had happened to them, or she was certain that Gregory was a cad and had fled so that he would not have to ever see her again. Or, in her saddest moments of all, she was convinced that her own coldness towards him when he had been leaving had driven him away. "But it doesn't matter. He was never going to marry you anyways," she reminded herself bitterly. There had never been any real hope, and now it was truly over. "Gregory still hasn't returned?" Nadine asked Vivian. "No, there has been no word from him at all. I have no idea what has become of him. And why should I even care? He showed up out of the blue, and now he has vanished again. Even my mother has started suggesting that I just give up on him," replied Vivian, trying to add a nonchalance to her voice that she did not at all feel. "I admit, Vivi, that I never believed he would just walk away without a word for months. I'm so sorry. It must be terribly hard on you," Nadine told her. They were sitting together outside of the sandwich shop by Vivian's apartment, near the bench where Gregory had once so formally, and in hindsight also so duplicitously, asked to court her. "It is hard, but I will be fine," said Vivian. "We are still going out to an evening motion picture on Friday, right?" "Well, no. That is actually part of what I came here to tell you. Frank and I have been invited to an evening out with one of Frank's colleagues from work," said Nadine, shifting uncomfortably. "That's all right," lied Vivian. "Go have a nice time. I will probably stay home then and finish the work on the skirt for Mrs. Austin. After giving up the grapefruit miracle diet, she has gained all her weight back and needs everything let out again." "Thank you for understanding, Vivi. You are a great friend, and I'm so glad that you are not upset," said Nadine. Vivian just nodded, but inside she felt very, very disappointed. When Friday came, she found that she did not want to sit at home. An angry feeling swept over her. Why should Nadine be out and having fun just because she had a beau, and Vivian did not? She had not told her mother that Nadine had canceled the evening, so now she ran to put on her shoes, and she hurried out before her mother had the chance to ask her any questions. She did not know exactly where she was going at first, but when the streetcar came and she got in, suddenly she knew where she would go. It was easy. Just keep putting one foot in front of the other. No thinking needed, she told herself. Her mind had been made up for some time now, she realized. If she had to spend one more night sitting alone with her mother and crying over Gregory like some crazy person, she would actually lose her mind. She wanted to feel like herself again. Calm and practical Vivian, at ease with her world and far from emotional suffering. She wanted to be done with Gregory. She wanted to let go. Her footsteps moved quickly along the pavement, one step at a time, hearing the noise grow louder as she came closer and closer. And then at last, she reached the open door of Silver Streak Bar, stepped through it, and found herself pulling up a chair at the counter. When had she realized that the story ended here, she thought, and a new story could start. Maybe she did not realize it until she had gotten on the streetcar just now.
had she ever done anything so unplanned and uncautious. She sat hesitantly, perched on the edge of her tall chair, suddenly keenly aware that the bar was full of men and she was just about the only girl in the place, when suddenly Chip came around behind the bar and the look in his eyes was unmistakable. "You came," he said, leaning closer to her. "Yes," she said. "I always knew you would come one day. Are you here alone?" he asked her in his unique accent. "What about your sweetheart? Or are you no longer spoken for?" "Not any longer," she said. She looked up at him, and his blue eyes sparkled despite the darkness inside the bar. Suddenly she was afraid. What if Chip did not want her either? What if he sent her home? Chip straightened up, looked down at her, and smiled at her in a way that made all of his previous smiles seem like candlelight compared now to the light of the sun. "In that case, let me say something that I have long wanted to say to you. Miss Vivian, you are the most beautiful creature that I have ever seen, and it has been worth the journey to America just to see you and to be able to speak with you." Chip's eyes shone. "You are simply stunning, and it would be my greatest pleasure if I could spend some more time with you and get to make your better acquaintance. And now I will make you a special cocktail that I just recently learned from a chap who tells me that everyone in Hollywood is ordering these now. Go more slowly this time and have just the one drink, all right?" Vivian nodded, trying to remember to feel embarrassed, but actually feeling overwhelmingly flattered and admired. Chip reached out his hand, gave her upper arm a light touch, and then turned to go back behind the bar to make her drink. She watched him work, efficient and focused, and remembered how he had effortlessly managed to clean an entire kitchen's worth of dirty dishes. When he was finished, he carefully placed the drink in front of her in its tumbler glass, a lime wedge balanced on its rim. "It's called an embassy cocktail," he said. "Cheers." She smiled and lifted the glass carefully, trying to disguise that her hand was slightly shaking. With a sip of this drink, she would start off in a new direction, along a new path, and the chapter that had lasted from the accident to meeting Gregory, to falling in love with him, to eventually losing him, would end, and anything left that still held them together would be severed. If Tristan and Isolde had drunk a love potion together, now Vivian was drinking an antidote. Once imbibed, there was no going back. "Don't be afraid, it won't bite you," said Chip. "It is an elegant drink. Take a sip." Vivian hesitated, then rallied her courage and lifted the glass to her lips. The taste of the cocktail was strong, bitter, and with a complicated citrus flavor. "Is this what sin tastes like?" she wondered. "No, this is what freedom tastes like," she told herself. She had nothing to feel ashamed about. Gregory had left without a single word for over 3 months. It had ended a long time ago already between them, and she was the only one still left even thinking about it. He had been free of her already for months. She sat at the bar and sipped her cocktail. In time, its smooth and pleasantly drowsy effect went to work on her, and she remembered how they had all fallen asleep under the trees in the afternoon after having the rum, when Chip had moved her intentionally to be closer to him. This drowsy sensation must be how alcohol worked, she thought. Chip served the other customers, then came back to speak with her. He leaned over the bar counter on his elbows, smiled handsomely,
and asked her how she liked her drink. She told him it was strong but good. He smiled wider. Then he asked her when she had to be home, and she remembered that she had told her mother that she was going to the motion pictures with Nadine, and her mother expected her to be home immediately afterward. Chip saw her hesitate and asked if she needed an escort home.
That would be very nice, agreed Vivian. But don't you have work to do here?
I do, but a chap has friends who can help him, at least I hope so. Wait here, I will be right back, he said. In another half hour, he was on the other side of the bar and walking Vivian out the door and into the night.
Where is it that we have been, then, when your mother opens the door? He asked her cautiously.
I went to see a motion picture with Nadine tonight, said Vivian, grateful to have Chip's arm to steady her, because it was quite dark and she did feel a bit unfocused after her embassy cocktail.
I see. And what film did you go see? Chip asked in a light tone.
I've no idea, admitted Vivian. What should I say?
I went to see Lost Horizon earlier this week, said Chip. Maybe you saw that?
Since I just saw it, I can tell you what happens. Should I fill you in case your mother asks?
Vivian nodded thankfully and then let Chip tell her the plot of the film. They had come to the streetcar stop. Chip stood next to her in the pale lamplight, and she suddenly thought that he had never looked handsomer than now, his pale hair gleaming where the shadows did not fall on it. She looked up at him, forgot to breathe, and then the embassy cocktail and his proximity combined forces, and she lost her head.
Will you kiss me? One day? Asked Vivian, her voice a shaking whisper, the alcohol from her drink gently coursing through her head. She desperately needed some assurance that this would be different than the relationship that she had had with Gregory, that Chip actually wanted her. Chip's eyes smoldered and he took sudden and firm hold of her upper arms.
As you Americans say, you bet I will, he said in a low, determined voice as his hand came around her back.
I realize this is still a kind of first rendezvous, but God, I have dreamed about you for months now. Oh, Vivian.
And with these words, he boldly reached a hand under her chin, tipped her mouth up, sighed, and then his eager, warm lips came down on hers and the empty, inconsolable, rejected, and starving feeling that she had been carrying inside of her for so long now vanished in the blaze of a huge fire that suddenly let loose within her. His kiss was confident and triumphant, his arms folded tightly about her, and he took possession of her so completely that in that moment he stripped off the second piece of her heart that would never heal.
Yes, I believe.